Good morning, everyone. This is Debbie Wells from Artful Enrichment, and I'm so excited today because we have a famous photographer, Robert Farber, with us today. And hopefully you all saw his video, but we're going to have a really exclusive talk with him and learn all about his artwork and all about his career, which is fascinating. Before we get into introducing Robert, I just want to mention that this is one of our first Artful Enrichment webinars that we are having, and I'm thrilled to be telling you about this new company. And what we're doing is virtual programs like what you're going to see right now, and also we're going back to our in-person scheduling, and it's very, very exciting to be back pounding the pavement with our Artful Soko friends that are in New York. And then the Artful Enrichment webinars will bring everybody from all over the world together. We can enjoy art in all different ways. And before I even had a chance to say anything, people are already coming in and introducing themselves. And we love when people say where they're from. So I know BJ is from Syracuse because she always tells us a weather report. So come on, BJ, tell us what the weather is like in Syracuse. And I know Alan is from Long Island, and Irene is the Upper East Side. We've got Long Island. We've got Hoboken. Ooh, we have somebody from Boston where it's sunny and cold. I'm in Long Island. So is Lori. Weather report in Syracuse, it's sunny and cool. That's pretty good considering because Syracuse doesn't always boast the best weather. But anyway, please, everyone, continue to sign in. I think we have some people from other countries as well today. So, and then Robert, where are you, Robert?
I'm actually in the south of Florida.
Ooh. Now,
been living in the south of France for the past over a year, and it got a little too chilly, so I'm here.
Oh, how nice.
90 degrees here yesterday.
I'm sorry?
It was 90 degrees here yesterday.
Oh, my goodness. Well, oh, and I see somebody's from Palm Beach. So she understands this Florida weather. But anyway, so we're just going to give people a little chance to come in. And thank you for introducing yourselves. We've already got over 30 people here. If for some reason people aren't able to watch the whole thing, or some people knew they never could make this schedule, that you're automatically going to get a recording probably later today, maybe even within the hour of this being over. So you'll be able to watch it 24/7. And I see that's my parents. That's Mo Silver wrote in and said that it was a great video, that he liked your video, Robert. So that the video is about an hour, right?
Well, the preview that you'll see is about 3 minutes, but it's on demand 24/7. And when it's actually officially released, you're getting a sneak preview. It's an hour long. We could come and go. And there's many other facets to it, which you'll understand.
And Robert has a lot of really nice videos that we're going to incorporate into this presentation. So we have like a few snippets here and there of gallery visits and some montages of some of his work. It's really, really nice. But anyway, and you're getting some compliments, Robert, on your video. And it's funny, the same person is complimenting, he's also named Robert. So what does that mean? So while we're letting everybody come in, Robert, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself in your own words?
Well, about myself in my own words. Wow. Well, I've been doing this professionally for 50 years. I know, and it's a long time. So I've had many experiences, and I started in an unusual way. A matter of fact, when I do a lecture, I kind of explain how I actually started. And I'll tell you, I went to a school at the University of Miami. I wanted to go to school for art, for design. I wanted to be an artist, but my parents said, no, you're not going to go to school for that. And I wound up going to the University of Miami. And one day I was walking on the beach, and I see, this was now in the 60s, and I see somebody sitting there knitting in the smallest string bikini you can imagine. I mean, you know, in the 60s, you didn't see it. And she's sitting there knitting, but she weighed around 400 pounds.
Oh,
and during bikini, I said, I wish I had a camera. And with that in mind, when I left school, I went out and bought myself a 35 millimeter camera with that in mind to record moments and times. And what wound up happening, which was a real kind of an education, I didn't know things technically, I just knew things aesthetically. And I started making these mistakes, and the mistakes that I made really started looking like paintings, and they were kind of satisfying to me. So they were satisfying to me to the point that I said, I have to frame these. And I went into these outdoor art shows around New York. And one of the big shows I went into was the Greenwich Village show, the big show in Washington Square. Now I'm talking about the early 70s. And when I went in, a woman comes up to me and she introduced herself. I remember her name. And she said, I'm the director of the show. And she said, are these paintings or photographs? And I said, no, these are photographs. I thought she was going to give me an award or whatever. She said, I'm the director and we don't allow photography. So I'm sorry, you'll have to leave. So they didn't recognize photography as an art form. They didn't recognize, there wasn't a category to enter into it. I actually entered these shows in graphic arts. And she actually stood there while I packed up, and next to me was somebody who made belt loops with brass buckles, and the other side, a candle maker, and I had to leave the show. Well, I followed after that. I went into, it was the first year they were doing a new show at the Carl Schurz Park by Gracie Mansion. And I went into that show, and it was from that show that somebody approached me, and they saw, I had a couple of nudes at the time in there, but everything else was still as landscapes. And I had one thing that was a vignette, and it was Rousseau's studio in Barbizon, France, and it looked like a painting. And a creative director comes up to me from one of the big ad agencies and said, I love the lighting and the way that mood and the feeling that you get out of that painter. She said, I'm doing a national ad, fashion ad for Cotton Incorporated. She said, if you could put a model in that setting, I'll give you that ad. So with that said, of course I could do it. So because of that, I became a fashion photographer. And it was from that same show, that same day or weekend, that another person approached me, and they were a publicist for one of the big publishers. And they said, you know, and I only had two nudes. And they said, these nudes are really beautiful. I'd love to introduce you to our editor. And I said, okay, which wound up to be my first contract that came a few years after that with my book release in 1976 called Images of Woman, a book of fine art nudes. So my career grew up parallel to each other, feeding off each other with both the, I didn't assist, which is a normal channel to getting into. And they fed off each other where I was getting ads for Revlon and Pond skin cream and beauty products, Caress soap and so forth. And because of the mood or the style of my work, I got asked to do other things. And I wound up doing a lot of fashion and started doing Bloomingdale's and Saks Fifth Avenue and all the women's magazines and GQ and GQ covers. And it was just my career grew. And my next books that came out were on fashion photography and more of the inner workings of the, because since I didn't assist, when I got hired to do the shooting with models and how to book a stylist, and who knows what a stylist is, you know, how do you book a model? Where does a model, how do they get paid? How do you work? Had no idea. And there was no way to find out at the time. And because there was nothing, when the publisher, because my image is a woman, the first book did pretty well, asked me to do the next book that you should do on fashion. They didn't think of the missing book. So I did a book called Fashion Photography, and it was the inner workings of the business. How do you book models? How do you do that? And that book did really well. They did use it for this movie, The Eyes of Laura Mars at the time with Faye Dunaway, and Columbia used it to promote the movie. So it really grew. It got my career really off to a start, and my other books came out over the years, which you'll see. And then Jackie Onassis brings me to Doubleday to do a book called By the Sea, which still has landscape. Anyway, you'll see the rest in
you're giving it all away. Okay, so let's
but I'm not.
Let's start off with a very short video, And this basically is not the whole video that you've already, that everyone's already seen, but just a small one, just to give everybody an idea of what this whole thing is about. Okay? It's only just a couple minutes. It's going to cover some of the things Robert just talked about.
I'd like to welcome you on a tour of my studio. I decided to create this tour because I get so many questions about how my career has developed and how my eye has evolved. And by showing you examples around the studio, it'll stimulate you to ask questions and have more of an understanding of my work. As a frustrated painter who wanted to go to art school, which is a whole other story, instead, I wound up becoming a self-taught photographer, never assisting, and started my career by showing my photography on the streets of New York. New York has always been a major inspiration to me. Of course, creatively, but also the craziness, the energy, the grid, the challenges, and of course, the opportunities. New York is where I wound up spending 50 years following an unconventional career path, where I had parallel growth in fashion and beauty, as well as with my fine art photography, with my first books coming out in 1976. During this tour, you'll notice how my style evolves. But a big influence on how it evolves is the environment that I'm in. It's my studio, my location, and that continues throughout my career and especially continues today, and you'll see why. So please come into the studio and I'll show you around.
Okay, I think we gave everyone a nice little taste.
Yeah, I think so. you could register it if you didn't see it on your own. It's 24/7, anytime on demand, and we want you to see it before. Then you could ask questions, but I think you're welcome to ask questions. You'll see enough from what Debbie says or what you ask me.
Yes, well, I think what I did was I watched the video and I broke it down into different categories and we'll go through them. And this is one of the nice things about being virtual is that you can chat and ask questions as we're going along. We'll do some question and answers at the end if you'd like, but I think it's more fun when they're interactive. So I'm looking at all the chats as we're going through. And already, Robert, you're getting compliments from people liking your work already, and wait till they see all the details on them.
Well, and I appreciate it.
Okay, so you talked a little bit about how you went from the idea of fine art with the grainy photography, and then you got into fashion and all that. But we're going to go through that little by little. And here I use as a collage all different. These are all original pieces of Robert's. So, fashion and beauty. Now you kind of stumbled into that, you said, but you're a master at it.
Well, it's just a lot of practice. It's just a matter of being inspired by different things, with whether I see films or movies from, for example, the image on the left has that more of that Hollywood type of lighting, which actually, by doing a commercial ad, which you'll see something from for Philip Morris, for Leo Burnett Advertising, I got asked in the 1980s to do the glamorous smoking of Hollywood and so forth. And it gave me an idea from that, because at that time, that kind of lighting was already old and dated. But then when this creative director was very clever about it, I learned from the commercial work, said, hey, this is a great idea. And I started applying to my own things. The one on the right is from an early fashion editorial that I did. And so it's different things, different moods, one in a studio, one outdoors and so forth.
We definitely capture the moods in all of these, but it's not just the lighting, it's also the composition. Like these two I put together because I thought the compositions were so spectacular. Like, how would you describe the one on the left, the vertical one?
Well, it's funny. You see, you're very sent. That's why you're a good tour guide for all the art, because you really picked up on it. On the one on the left, with the red dress, that was a shooting for Saks Fifth Avenue. And you mentioned a composition. So what's really interesting about that is in this shooting, in the ad that we shot, this was actually shot at the Kansas City Museum of Art, or one of the museums in Kansas City, because Saks Fifth Avenue wanted me to shoot in every major city that they had a Saks to shoot a different cover. So when we shot this, because it's fashion, the composition with it wasn't the same as this. And it's funny, I never discussed this, but you're mentioning it, because I didn't really have the vase in that one for them because they wanted to see the dress. But I said, you know what, a more interesting composition, and this I shot for myself, I just raised the camera up to do this. And the way I actually lit her face was with a pocket, around 6-inch pocket mirror, to reflect right into her face. And so that's how we shot that. By the way, all of these things that I'm describing, this studio tour is made for two people that we just showed, for two markets. One is for the art collector, and the other is for the photographer who wants to know the creative process and styles. And we're doing a special release of that as a coaching mentorship thing. So these things I'm telling you are kind of part of that. So I like that you're asking. The one on the right was actually, I was shooting some ads for Cunard, and that's called the Amazon because it was on the Amazon River in Brazil. And it was just one of the mood type of images that she was standing at the railing, and I just wanted that calming, beautiful feeling that way. And I shot that. And actually, it's funny, it's just 40 by 60, think of it. And
it is interesting. It's interesting how you're describing the difference between your eye as a photographer, as a fine art photographer, and your eye as a commercial photographer.
Well, it's no difference. And it's an interesting question you're saying. There's no difference in that, because when they're hiring me, and what's helped me in my success of my career is I got hired because of my style and the look of my work. So, when you get into the, you know, they give you a layout, maybe what they want, but they usually hire you because of your style. So I shoot it, I interpret it the way I want to shoot it.
Wonderful. Okay. So Robert, another Robert is asking that you walked around and drove around looking for what to photograph. Can you articulate what you were looking for and what catches your eye? And I'm going to take you to the next slide while you answer the questions.
Now, are we talking about a commercial or my, either way, it's the same answer. Because what we'll do, like for example, like with Bloomingdale's, I was shooting Bloomingdale's and we wound up shooting 2 or 3 days out of the week for their advertising. And we would just, in New York, for example, we would get in a Winnebago or a motorhome, you know, with the models and hair and makeup stylists and so forth. and we drive around. I didn't want to take a look at locations ahead of time because the situation always changes with the lighting. So we follow the light, whatever is beautiful, to shoot spontaneously. And I do the same thing, whether I'm shooting my images of New York or by the sea or whatever else, I try to do it spontaneously.
By the way, in this little montage here, the one on the left, keep that one in mind as we go through this presentation, because you're going to see that in a future series, right? Isn't that one of the deterioration?
One of the ones that deteriorated, which you'll see.
Okay, so let's continue on.
And it's just a matter of the elegance. The center one is more of that 19, the old Hollywood look. And the one on the right is shot on the Mediterranean and just an elegant, simple line. But it's funny because I always shot these, and now they're in the galleries as classic fashion images, like a limited edition prints, because they have a nice elegance to it. So shooting for myself was a really important thing that worked well for me now.
Wonderful. Okay, so now we're going to get into another little video of your nudes. So let me get into that. Hold on 1 second.
Ne me quitte pas, il faut oublier tout, peut s'oublier qui s'enfuit déjà, oublier le temps des malentendus et le temps perdu, à savoir comment. Oublier ces heures qui tuaient parfois à coups de pourquoi le cœur du bonheur ne me quitte pas, ne me quitte pas, ne me quitte pas, ne me quitte pas. Moi, je t'offrirai des perles de pluie venu de pays où il ne pleut pas. Je creuserai la terre jusqu'après ma mort pour couvrir ton corps d'or et de lumière. Je ferai un domaine où l'amour sera roi, où l'amour sera loi, où tu seras reine. Ne me quitte pas, ne me quitte pas, ne me quitte pas, ne me quitte pas. Ne me quitte pas, je t'inventerai des mots insensés que tu comprendras. Je te parlerai de ces amants-là qui ont vu deux fois leur cœur s'embraser. Je te raconterai l'histoire de ce roi mort, de n'avoir pas pu te rencontrer. Ne me quitte pas.
That is really beautiful. And what's interesting is when you see it set to music, it really gives it a whole new dimension.
It adds a mood to it.
So I have one technical question before we continue. Suzanne wants to know, by the way, she's impressed with your career, which she said spans an incredible arc of changes in photography technology from film to digital. She'd love to know if you still work with film and if you do any of your own manual development of the film.
Tell you the truth, I always hated developing. In the very beginning, it was when I first started and playing with photography, I thought it was magic the way it came out. But after that, I didn't want to create things in a dark room. I wanted to spend my time shooting. So I'm not working with film. I've been involved with Canon quite a bit. And when things started changing to digital, I was really hesitant to do it because, as you could see, the way I work with film and the way I work with film is experimenting with different films, grain, different things, and digital never gave you the personality that you got out of film. Mm-hmm. And because of that, it was a different challenge. So I've learned how to manipulate, not the film in Photoshop. Photoshop, forget. That's not what I'm, it's kind of, I still want to be trained. I mean, as a photographer, and I teach anyone to do it, to get transparency film and shoot with the camera, and whatever you shot on transparency is kind of what you got. You can't change it. So as a photographer, and I depend on digital now, and the feeling I get out of it is just the way I handle the ISO, underexpose it, and when I bring it into Photoshop, it's not to manipulate it and not to change it, but to the extent in the darkroom to really work with the exposure, contrast, saturation, but nothing more. So to answer your question, I haven't been shooting with film, but I wanted to. And when I went to get in my studio, when I came back from a trip and I wanted to get my film camera, I noticed that they were stolen. So I'm serious. I had a whole series of my film cameras I had away. They were stolen, and it just stopped it for some reason. And I just haven't really gone back to film, not for that reason, but I just a little side note. But so I'm just handling regular digital as if they were film.
Well, I'm just going through these photographs so everyone can enjoy them. Oh, Suzanne.
Example like this one, it's in my book, Classic Barber Nudes. I shot this, and at the time I had a contract with Minolta Camera Company, and they just came out with the first autofocus cameras, and they also had a chip in it, and the chip allowed you to do multiple exposures. So this is shot on film with a computer chip that automatically shot the multiple exposures for me, and I created some different effects with it. So it was done at the time of shooting, not even in a darkroom.
I love this one. This is one of my favorite ones that you did. It's just, it just sets a mood, and it's just so beautifully done. And Suzanne is saying it's a beautiful, that you're doing a beautiful combination of manual and digital work, so.
Well, thank you. And by the way, it's funny because I have so many images. I haven't put this in the galleries yet, and I want to. And I really, I do agree. I really do like this image.
Yeah, this is wonderful. Okay, and here's some more. And you can see Robert's play with lighting and with the way he's dealing with the architecture and the texture of everything. I mean, you can see the texture of the column, the softness of the drapery, the wood on the door. What do you want to talk about, any of these two?
Sure, yeah. The one on the left was shot in Tuscany, and just using the directional light and highlighting the model as you see it. And the thing that I've always done with my nudes is, unless it's a beauty shot or something, I hide the face so there's more of a mystique to it. So there's no, you can't really associate it with anyone. It's like an invasion of privacy, you know, so it's just a certain mood the way I keep it. And the one on the right, I shot it actually it's funny, it was a former J.P. Morgan Estate in Newport, Rhode Island. Huh. And the owner of the estate, the current estate, who I knew through a friend of mine who's a major art dealer, was representing the new owner. And his name was Felix de Welden. Now, you probably don't know who Felix de Welden is, but he was a great sculptor of monuments. He, for example, one of his known monuments is raising a flag at Iwo Jima at Arlington National Cemetery. Mm-hmm. He lived in that estate, in that house in Newport, Rhode Island. And I loved the house, and I used to go shoot there. So I shot this with the columns, the marble columns at the house, the one on the right. It's funny, there's stories behind every image, you know, and you can keep going that are just great memories. And it's the stories behind the images that really something special to it.
Well, that's why we're here, because we want to hear these stories.
We don't have enough time, so I'll talk here.
So what about these two? The one on the right, it keeps reminding me of Academy Award statue. But well, that's not what it is.
That's a nude I took. Well, just a reflection of the diving board. It was on a Polaroid in black and white film with my camera. And it was just her standing on the edge of the diving board reflected on the water and shot in the evening. And the light was coming from the pool. That, and on the left is, God, it's from my, I never put this from the Images of Women book, but it was one of young publishers that I had. And it's from shot out in the Hamptons. And early morning, and it's from my Images of Women book.
Now, believe it or not, I think we have a lot of photographers here with us right now because somebody asked another question. Barbara says, how much cropping, if anything, do you do in your development process?
Nothing. Everything is composed with the camera completely.
Oh, interesting.
Oh, completely, yeah. I mean, if I can't compose it with the camera, then I'm not using. Because like I said, I'm using, in the color, when it came to film, I shot with the transparency. So everything is full frame transparency or black and white negative film.
So when you're looking through the camera, you're saying to you, and you know, you can see exactly what you see. And do you say, this is going to be a winner? Do you know?
Well, I get excited about some of them. And I know what I do know is, and it's funny, it's some of the things that I teach in my thing, like you could struggle with a shot, you know, you have a model and a feeling and what, and if it's not there, it's just not there. You have to walk away from it. Right. When it's there, you know it and you shoot it. But
I just that's felt like magic.
Pardon me?
It's when you feel like that magic moment when it turns
right.
Something.
Mm-hmm. And then I would do variations of the shot, but I don't exhausted with film or more. Even in the digital days, I just, you know, now I take the ones that I feel and that's it.
Okay. Now this one, first of all, talk about composition. I love this one, but this is also a nice transition into another subject that you do, which is landscapes. But tell us how you did this because the colorization looks a little different there.
Well, actually, this was on a shooting. This is funny. This was on a shooting for Saks Fifth Avenue in the Canary Islands in Lanzarote in Spain, and to do fashion. But of course, I'm here. I'm taking advantage of it. So I'm shooting my own things. And it's just a matter of having the body form like that with the background as it is in just an interesting composition. And it's funny. I never put this. It's in my, I think it's in the Moods book, which came out in, no, it isn't in the movies, but it's later than that. But anyway, but I never put this in the galleries. There's so many images that I love that I revisit it. And if you didn't bring it up, I probably would have forgotten about it.
I guess I looked at it with fresh eyes and I got excited about different images without asking you which ones you wanted, so.
You're a good curator, so thanks.
Okay, so let's get into the landscapes. Now, talk about stories. You'll tell us the locations of all of these places, too.
You know, it's funny you're mentioning it, and this is not what I would say about stories, but it's really funny because I was spending most of my time in L.A. at the time, and I remember exactly when it was shot. This was in Kansas, in the plains of Kansas. What happened is, I was waiting to my new book at the time was Natural Beauty Farmer Nudes, which was coming out, and it was a Rizzoli's and book and Merle Publishing, and they were going to be printing it at a great printer EBS in Italy, and they were going to let me know when it was going to be on press, and I would only have a few days notice of it. So I took a trip just to shoot my own things. And I left L.A. on my own and went as far as I could go until I could get the call that it's time, press time for it, with a few days notice. And I pulled over to the side of the road to get that call. And this happened to be right there in Kansas. I just left Dodge City and was there. And I shot that. And it's funny, I didn't even think of that until you mentioned it. But I remember exactly. And it's in one of my books, I forgot. Okay, anyway, that's the story of it. And on the left is from Malibu, and it's in my By the Sea book. On the right is Santa Barbara, shot with a Polaroid black and white film through my camera.
Okay.
And if anyone has any questions, please.
Yes, I'll read them to you as they come along.
Is I was actually I was teaching at the Toscana Photography Workshop, and I just took this at the time in Tuscany.
And this is a non-manipulated picture, you're saying?
No, manipulation. Don't say that word. I don't do it. Even the ones that look, you'll see in a little while, the ones that look manipulated are all natural. I'm a natural guy.
Well, I love this one. I've been to Tuscany, so I know exactly what these scenes look like, and you really captured it. I didn't even have to ask you where this was, because between the colors and the shapes of the trees and just the way you compose it is just beautiful.
Thank you.
Okay, so now let's get into New York. Before we start talking about it, you want to show our little movie on it?
Sure, please. Yeah.
All right, hold on. Let me get that together. Hold on one second.
New York, to that tall skyline I come, flying in from London to your
you cut it off too soon. The best part was at the end, but it's all right. But people could go, you can watch it on your own.
Yes, we're going to send you all these links so you can watch them on your own. You know what? I think you just really captured the mood of New York. And by the way, Suzanne is writing again saying that she's very impressed that you were able to do all of this in a viewfinder. And I think a lot of these New York shots really show how good you are at composing these compositions.
Thank you. But yeah, and that's the thing that bothers me with Photoshop and afterwards doing it, that you have to do it through the camera. You know, I'm not a darkroom technician or whatever, but it's more of a challenge. And then don't leave it up to Photoshop to create the image. You really should do it as a photographer at the time you do it. I guess I'm just a purist or been doing it too long.
But you know what? I'm looking at the one with the sidewalk on the right, and just the fact that you realized that the shadows of the street signs were creating a line. you know, that's parallel to the two chalk lines of the you know, the street. Just, you know, you can really see how you were noticing all these things as you were shooting them. The same thing with Statue of Liberty.
And it's funny because this was actually done with the Polaroid Polapan black and white film that went through the camera.
So
instant that I was able to shoot. If you knew that film, it was absolutely great. I used it for a number of things, and I absolutely love the film. So it wasn't available. Anyway.
By the way, Ellen is saying that she loves the music accompanied by the videos, and you kept pushing me to do that. You kept saying, show as many videos as you can. You're right.
Well, it kind of gives it the mood. It adds to it, you know.
And now look at this one. You're just, the whole painterly way that you approach these photographs is so evident. Just the way that you have a fairly monochromatic palette, and then you have those graphic words shining through, and just the way the light is hitting the buildings.
You're making me start to appreciate this picture.
Well, you know, that's the thing. I'm feeling like, the more I look at, you know, I've looked at your work a lot, putting this whole thing together, and I feel like the more I look at it, the more I'm falling in love with them and capturing all these details. Like, for example, those ladders that you can see, what do you call those? You know,
the fire escape
for a ladder. you know, thank you. I couldn't think of the word. When you look at that, it's very faint. But it's there, and you can see that the lighting is only picking up little pieces of it. You first realized.
Well, the subtleties of it, and I love the grainy film and so forth. Mm-hmm. And this is like a slide film, transparency film, you know, and you can't manipulate it. You know, it's there, and it's well, I like the way you. You're a good curator. You make me appreciate my own work.
Well, that's good. Well, actually, Ellen is saying here that it reminds her of Hopper, and we actually are going to mention that. So,
of course, I was influenced by all the painters, and that was my whole thing.
I know it says Julian Billiards on it, but I can't help but notice Ray's Pizza, because I want to know, is that the original Ray's Pizza or?
Oh yeah. You see, there's no zip code on, no area code on it. It says 212. So it's got to be, even though Julian's billboard is on 14th Street. Actually, I was doing a fashion shooting with this. This was, it was 89.
Uh-huh.
But the bicycle has got to be about 20 years old, you know. So, and they since tore this down on 14th Street.
Well, I think it shows, these kinds of pictures show that you have an old soul, because that vintage feel comes through no matter what.
Old soul. It's old, yeah.
So now we go to the next category of techniques and technology. We've touched about that a little bit already, but here's a quote from you where you said, if you want to make good photographs, a camera is second nature to you. Devoting too much attention to technical decisions can interfere with your career process, which I think you've pretty much touched on already, explained it.
Right. Simply, I agree.
Okay, so we talked a little bit about painterly look and that grainy feel of the light coming in and so on. So here, now you can really take a close-up of some of the beautiful examples.
Well, and that's what I absolutely love, just walking around, like the image on the right. I actually went to an old convent in New Jersey to photograph the nuns, because it was the old world look that I was looking for, with the directional light and so forth. And this one nun who was showing me around, one of the little vignettes that I found with these lights, these old light fixtures just sitting there. So I photographed it with it like that. And I photographed another image with her with the light and so forth. And I never asked her to do nudes, of course, but I took a lot of still lives there. And that was that picture. That must have been, wow, that was sort of around 1968,
I believe. It's timeless.
Yeah, and the one on the left is on the back cover of my book, Moods, which came out in 1980. I called it Crosses Flowers. It was actually, I wound up getting involved in posters. And this was 1980 that it became a poster. The book came out in 1980. It became a poster in 1980. And it was the first one called Crosses Flowers. It was my neighbor named Cross had a farm upstate New York, and it was at their house that I shot this still life. So, and it wound up actually being the first poster I had that came out of 73 posters that really came out over the 1980s.
Wow.
But I found that, well, the posters did great. They showed up all over the world and it was wonderful and everything else. But it was something that I stopped doing in the 80s, after 1980s, because it was like too much and it was diminishing the value I thought of my work if I was just doing the posters. So I just completely stopped it, unless it was a commemorative poster for an opening or something.
So, that makes sense. We're going to talk more about edition prints and so on when you purchase artwork a little bit later. Before we continue, I just want to tell you that BJ wrote that she has a Canon 7D and that she's always looking for things to capture as well. So she goes around, same like you, small rural towns in upstate New York and sees whatever she stumbles upon. And I think that's similar to what you're saying.
Oh, totally. It's, you know, that's the best way. Just, you know, get in your car, just travel alone if you could, you know, is better. Because I had company with me and sometimes I start honking a horn. Come on, what are you doing?
So tell us about this. This was not something you stumbled across, I hope.
No. I was teaching a workshop, the main photographic workshop in the early 80s. And this older man who was in the workshop with his big Hasselblad and his light meter around his neck. And I had a recording film, you know, a very grainy high-speed recording film in a camera, and it was kind of a little foggy and everything else. And he was just working with a model initially, and I just had to shoot this. I thought it was something special. I never did anything with it, but it's something, well, I'm doing with something with it right now. So, but I'll make it a gallery image, but I have so many images that, you know, that is a whole other story. On the left is Mark Twain. On the right is Moses. Now, on the left is Mark Twain. My former brother-in-law was a real Mark Twain fanatic, and he dressed up. He spent 6 hours getting ready and dressing up like Mark Twain. He was a professor of psychobiology up at the University of Maine or whatever. He was in Bar Harbor. And I went up and like lit him by a kerosene lantern, not regular lighting, so captured the old thing and printed it on this old ortho paper. And on the right was a rabbi that came to my first studio for a donation. And I said, well, I'll give you a donation for shul if you let me photograph you. So we wound up doing all these nudes in there. No, I'm kidding. So I took some portraits of him. And it was actually my book, Moods, which came out in 1980.
And I'm beginning to like these two of these next to each other. I just like the way that you see the contrast between them.
Well, that's your talent, because as a curator, you're the one that's really putting this slideshow together. So that's great.
Well, okay, now everybody get ready for this is the best video you're going to see. Watch this one. This is part of his deterioration series, and you might recognize some of the work that you see, but let's take a look at this video. I think that is amazing. So now explain what your whole philosophy of this is.
Well, it's part of this whole thing I'm doing with this video art and the morphing and the different images. And it really comes from my Woman as Art project because I was showing how things evolved and the deterioration pieces and where they came from. And that's where it went into this whole video art pieces.
So these images are printed on metal, but then how do they move? Like how is it
Oh,
composed?
well, this is these are just prints that are part of the deterioration series, and these are large prints around 74 inches by 42 inches, and there are famous models, and it's all part of that deterioration where the images started. I put them in non-archival sleeves to store them, and I went to revisit them over the years. And I found they were starting to deteriorate. So I about maybe 8 years ago now, I took them out of the sleeves and I said, wait a minute. I looked at them again and said, these look really great. What's happening to them? It's natural organic process. And what's happening to them is it's starting as if I manipulated it. And it's just a natural organic process of the images deteriorating, which is pretty, a metaphor for us deteriorating in a way.
Yes.
A number of them, I was just kidding around with the models, and I had a whole sheet of slides in these vinyl sleeves that we were just joking around with the models, and that whole sleeve deteriorated. So that's where these strange ones came from. That they happen to do that also. So there, then they also came out in a book, which I think you have on here, but it's part of the deterioration series, which has been quite successful for me. And
Not only is it a good recycling of photographs, but also it is a metaphor. And I like the way you call it deterioration series and making it into a video, the way you see it morphing is it's very interesting.
well, it's yeah, it's just evolving and evolving vision over the years.
Well, Sue is saying, we got a lot of Susans and Suzannes here. Susan is saying that she loves your sense of humor. And Suzanne is saying that she is pretty sure that you've been inspired by other people's photography. And it's funny that you say that, Suzanne, because we have a little segment on that coming up. And let's see, and Lisa is saying that it's inspiring to see how you make the best out of unexpected situations. I think that's part of being a creative person.
You mean a lemonade out of lemons?
Exactly. Here's another one. The deterioration series was one. Tell us about the wet series.
And by the way, the studio tour takes you through all of these videos with this, the whole process of it. So if you have a chance to see it, you'll see it in total, you know. Anyway, and this was the flood that I had in the studio, which was 2018, and the flood, one of a series of small 8x10 pictures that weren't done are printed archivally, but they're just printed on a desktop printer for the purpose of catalog these 100 or so images, and that got wet in the flood, and the ink started flowing into each other, and I started taking them out, looking at it, I said, wow. Some of these things are really, yeah, I love the way they're doing it. I eliminated all the images that were not ruined, and the ones that were, we dried out the sheets of paper and scanned them, and we came out with the wet series, which is just about being released now. It's something, one of the newer things that we're releasing, and they're on some galleries now, but we haven't officially kind of let them out. So there's a whole series of the wet series. You can probably look on my website and see them, but or wherever. This is more from the wet series. And they're being done quite large too.
And like we said, we will send links and information on this afterwards if you haven't picked up on some of the things that we've said. This image with the spiral, What is that about? Because I've seen that a little bit.
Well, too. Actually, in that nude one, you can only see part of it. That's the whole image. It was a nude with the shadow of the wrought iron railing from the mm-hmm. sun coming through. And that looks beautiful in a regular image, but mm-hmm. it's quite interesting, you know, the way it ran and bled the same way. And just as these were like stuck together on the side and they, from the wet series. It was from one of my, it was from the Natural Beauty book, I believe.
Okay, so now Suzanne was asking about other photographers. We're way ahead of you, Suzanne. We have it already planned out. So tell us about them. He's your idol. Did you actually knew him, Horst?
Horst B. Horst. He was like, he did all the Vogue covers in the 20s, 30s, and just a great photographer. It was very inspiring, but I did know him, and ACFA Film Company was doing a worldwide campaign, and they asked whoever I want to photograph, or they'll photograph you and you photograph them, and we'll run different ads. Like the one on the right's in, or the one on the left's in German, the one on the right's in English. But so he did something typical of the way I would shoot, I did something typical of the way he would shoot, and they ran these magazine ads to promote the film. So, but that was Horst, and what a great photographer he was. About 91 or 92, not the year, but the age. And he's, a special person.
So now this is something that Horst was someone that you told me about, but then I was thinking about other fashion photographers and New York photographers, and I just thought that these were good people to compare your work to. Were you thinking about any of these people, like Irving Penn or Abbott?
No, I mean, I love the Abbott's New York pictures and things, and I mean, I'm inspired by so many things, and mostly in film, you know, with motion picture film. Only because of your exposure to the European, you know, as far as European great movies that really, you know, add some inspiration. But as far as like Irving Penn, I knew his son, and I met him at a cocktail party. My neighbor was Grace Mirabella, who is the editor of Vogue, and she invited me to a Christmas party. And I met him, Irving Penn, and Avedon. Of course, I was a kid compared to him, and I'm still a kid now. I'm inspired by, you know, many photographers, but mainly by painters, because that was my frustration of, you know, as far as the directional light of the Dutch and painters or Vermeer or whatever, or the softness of the impressionistic painters. But everything inspires me visually for different things, you know.
Your love of New York, the reason I put Berenice Abbott in here is because there's actually a really nice exhibit at Marlborough in Chelsea coming up right now. Of Greenwich Village. That's what made me think of her. Okay, so let's continue on. And here are two other photographers. Did we put a painter in here? I know we talked about Hopper. I don't think we put an example of it in here. Richard Avedon, another great. And did you ever see this one of Lee Miller? Do you know about this photograph?
No, I don't.
It's called Hitler's Bathtub. And this, was Lee Miller, a fashion model, and also a girlfriend, friend of Picasso. But she also was a fashion photographer and a journalistic photographer. And during World War II, she filmed a lot of things going on in Europe. And this was after Hitler, you know, left. This is his bunker. That's what she's actually in his bathtub.
Wow.
Isn't that interesting? Okay, so let's continue on. Okay.
Come to this lecture.
Well, we've got model celebrities, influential people. We could go on forever talking about all these people that you mentioned, but why don't you just pick out one or two and tell us about them?
Well, you know, it's funny, like Omar Sharif, I got hired to do a movie with Omar Sharif and Ava Gardner was in. It was a movie of the week for ABC, shot in Sevilla, in Seville, Spain. And before they would send me to do it, they would send some of my books of nudes or whatever to the celebrities, so let them know that maybe they're sending somebody special for them, you know, whatever it was. And Omar Sharif was absolutely great and really just absolutely great to work with. Where somebody like George C. Scott, what an anal passage he was. you know, it was like he didn't have time or whatever. He just wasn't. And little, you know, I don't want to be the one to tell him, but I say more people are going to see this than see your movie. So this is the packaging that's going to sell your product. You know, these things go through my mind. I knew the right places to say it or not to say it. There's just models that I've worked with, and Michael Douglas was great. And I'm not, it's funny, I'm not a celebrity photographer. I just wound up doing a lot of movie ads over the years. James Cole, a whole other experience. Actually, his son,
Scott,
came with a driver when we were done shooting. He was 2 years old at the time. His son Scott, he asked me to photograph the two of them, so I did the two of them. Now, his son is an actor. This story is with everyone. Danny DeVito was a really good guy, and Farrah Fawcett was wonderful. We created a scene that didn't exist in the film and shot it in Paris, where she's running out of a studio. Anyway, there's.
Did you know she was a sculptress too? She was a sculptor.
No, really?
Yes,
no,
yes. Yes, we've actually seen some of her work at a gallery on 57th Street a few years ago.
No, I didn't know. Actually, we picked her up. I remember at our hotel, she was there with Ryan O'Neill at the time. And there's good and bad to tell about everybody, so I'm not going to say anything.
Well, but I have to tell you, I can't look at almost every single person on your list. They're all beautiful. So it must be really beautiful.
Well, it's funny because Fabio, I was directing some film things and this production company. So we're going to do a romantic video for Fabio, just for the video market. And they said for me to direct. So they had me, we got a writer who did the novels, and he was on the cover of those novels and everything else to do a story, Time for Romance. So I had to do this whole series of him as a pirate, him as an Italian lover, all these different things in a film directing. And I'm telling him, I said, no, don't look at the girl like this. And he goes, you're going to tell me how to look at a beautiful girl like that? No, just for the camera, I'm telling you. It's like, just, you know, this is all, anyway.
That's funny. Okay, so now we'll talk just very briefly. Look at the commercial work that you've done. It's pretty incredible. I mean,
don't tease me. That's something that I did before.
We're happy you're with us today.
No, yeah, of course. Not satisfied too many people, but it was rewarding. Anyway, some of it, yeah.
Well, let's talk about your brush with fame with Jackie Onassis.
Well, I get a call from my literary agent, and she said that I got a call from Jackie Onassis' office and at Doubleday, and she likes your work and she wants to know what you're working on. So I said, that's great. And this is, boy, I'll tell you, at the time, my wife was never impressed with anything I did. When I told her about the phone call, she doesn't remember this. She said, I'm impressed. And anyway, so you go into the office, have a meeting with her, and I showed her the carousel tray and the images and everything else. And we go into this little conference room and give her a slideshow, and I took pictures around the Riviera, and she said, well, why don't we do a book called By the Sea? And can't you smell the corn on the cob and all? And I remember specifically everything that, you know, she was saying, even everything she was wearing, even her mannerisms when she walked me to the elevator at the end of the meeting. I mean, there's lots of stories and things. Anyway, continue. And then this book came out a few years ago of her as the editor, and they mentioned the By the Sea book, and that's where you got that cover from, I guess.
Yes, sure is. Okay. Here are some other celebrity models. These are beautiful. Hyman one was one of the deterioration ones as well, wasn't it?
One of the Iman ones, yes. Iman, when she was first starting, which was around 78, 77, she did the cover for my first fashion book and other pictures I did. And then I wound up working with her over the years with that. She married, as you know, David Bowie, and I have so all these, you know, image. And she was really beautiful in way, you know. She's very exotic looking, and she still is. And then the other one was Miss Universe. I shot another Miss Universe in Mexico for endorsing water, and we shot that. And then there was a hair product that were the other Miss Universe, Olivia, was coming out and asked me to do a series of beauty shootings with her. So that's who that was. And I had to deal with the Trump organization because they were partners with NBC in the Miss Universe pageant. So all of these girls work for Trump model agency. They were all Miss Universes were under contract with the Trump model agency. And if you don't know it, he became a president of the United States.
I heard.
Anyway, continue.
Beverly Johnson, also a very big model. I love this picture.
She was the first black model on the cover of Vogue magazine. And I worked with her quite a bit. And this was shot in Marrakesh in Morocco. And it's just lit up by the late day sun. And I did a lot of travel with it quite a bit, all over on different things. So we worked quite a bit together. She really is really beautiful. And well, I could keep going with these stories, but.
Well, this one's especially interesting because Gia was a big model at the time, and they even made a movie about her.
Yeah, and so Jolie played her in her first film, the interesting thing is I shot her over a number, you know, of years because she died of AIDS from heroin needles and so forth, and really tragic. She was really kind of beautiful, but I shot her from the beginning on to into the early 80s, I would say. And then I think she passed away, was it 86 or something? So it was actually Jolie's first film. And I did with the Selects Gallery, we did a whole retrospective type of thing of hers that I did in July. Last July or last June. And so I have all of these different images and that Roberta Flack video. But Debbie will supply these links and you can see it.
Yes, absolutely. Okay, so we've seen the beautiful people, the beautiful landscapes, beautiful still lives, beautiful nudes, beautiful everything. So now here's the big question. Where do we find all these things of yours?
I would say your neighborhood bookstore, but Amazon.
That's, well, here are just some of the books. How many did you do in total? 7?
15.
15.
And then, you know, revisions and that kind of thing. But you could, some of the out of print ones you could find on Amazon or Barnes & Noble online, and or, but the most recent one was the $18,000 one. First edition one. But I'm happy to tell you it is none available. It's, you know, it's like they only made 18 of them.
You know? Okay, you sold out.
Well, they sold out. The publisher did. But you can look on my website and see these, but you can look on there. But on the, can you go back one?
Sure.
I wanted to see what, because there was something. Yeah, and, you know, our, well, just if there's an interest in any of these gallery images or something, just let us know at info@farber.com or the books, or just put it in, Google it, or ask Debbie.
It's very easy to find. Now, tell us about your interest in breast cancer research.
There's actually, you don't have that video. It explains it all. Anyway, just quickly, I got involved.
We want you.
Well, I did that cover. It was in, I think, 94. But I, over the years, my mother, early 60s, got diagnosed with breast cancer. I didn't even know what breast cancer was then. And after mastectomy, she, you know, thank God, was fine. And then I got asked to do a breast cancer cover around 94, I believe it was. And then after that, a friend of mine, who was on her first cover of Self magazine, was diagnosed with, I was with her that evening when she found it, with breast cancer. She did Diane's Diary. And because she was on her first cover of Self, and Conte Nast did it for 1 year, what a woman goes through with breast cancer. And she wound up going from remission to going through her body, and she wound up passing away. And I dedicated my natural beauty book to her, Diane Erickson. And I got involved with the Evan Lauder, which was just coming out with Breast Cancer Research Foundation. And I got involved with them and made a nice donation from that opening we had with the book. And then after that, my brother about 16 years ago got diagnosed with breast cancer, and I didn't even know men were susceptible to it. And he had a double mastectomy. And actually what wound up happening since is just 6 months ago, they found it came back on him. So he's going through treatments for it too. So I've been heavily involved with breast cancer and helping raise funds for Breast Cancer Research Foundation. And there's a link to it that we'll give you. And we have a special printing that we do for breast cancer. If you donate $50 to breast cancer, you can get this special thing and so forth. And with my Woman is Art exhibition, as well as this new thing with the studio tour, is one of the sponsors is LVMH, Louis Vuitton, Moët Chandon, and they came out with a new tequila, and that they've been a sponsor and working, helping all this, everything else that I mentioned, and that's what Volcan is. So it's a new high-end tequila by them. I'm involved with them, and they're part of the studio tour and also helping in other charitable ways.
Okay, so now we're getting down to the nitty-gritty now. So, you know, you've been philanthropic, you're involved in all these collaborations, but one of the things that you got, everybody got with the video book, with the video, was this commemorative ebook, and it's basically a catalog explaining all the things that you can get through Robert Farber of his work. So tell us about what's in this book.
Well, this is everything we've been talking throughout my career and all the different links and all the videos that we mentioned. It's all linked through here, and it's just all the information that you might want, or the videos that I don't have time to show you, and this is, let me read what's in it. It's a flip book that I think you'll appreciate, and it explains about all this, including for people that do the studio tour and that Debbie has been doing. And I usually do that when I have the original reason for the studio tour. It was great when people came through the studio, and as a kind of, if they were interested in the work and they weren't, you know, really collectors that couldn't afford the larger gallery images that are priced, I did a special edition just for that are not available in galleries. There are smaller, beautiful prints that are done just as well. These are from some of the gallery shows. No, that's not Holden Lund's on the right. He's in Palm Beach. That's from the Yarger Fine Arts in Beverly Hills on the right. But it's okay.
The galleries that you can buy his limited edition prints from in the U.S.
Or a Selects Gallery in New York. There's a bunch of them, but if you actually send an email to Debbie or info@farber.com, if anyone's interested in any of these images and want to hear more about it from me personally, we'll get on a Zoom call and I can tell you about specific images if you're interested.
It's not just the images, you also do mentoring with photography skills. Am I right?
Yes, in this studio tour, we're doing a whole mentoring and coaching program, both the one-on-one and other things. Not to teach you have to know about f-stops and shutter, you know, so not to teach the technical things, but the creative process, the marketing things that are a little higher end, you know, more for very serious photographers.
So these are some of the more galleries from around the world, because Robert, you're everywhere. And again, we can give you a list of galleries.
To look like a Visa card everywhere you want to be.
Yes, exactly. Let's show one more video of Paris, of a gallery in Paris. Is that okay?
Sure.
And then we'll talk about our special arrangement just for everybody that's listening today. Which am I doing? Which one was it, Robert?
It's the one from the Paris, art show in Paris was.
Okay, we're going to skip that for the moment. So let's just continue on. I'm sorry. So now, if you didn't want to buy any galleries and you want to take advantage of this offer, Robert, why don't you explain what this studio tour print collection is?
Well, this is, like I said, that's not available in galleries, but I do it for people that are new collectors, younger collectors, or that want the quality of, you know, of the print, but they're smaller and they're just initialed and dated on the back, and they're not edition prints, and they're not available in galleries. And there's a 12 by 16 they of any of these images from this grouping.
Just the categories. There's a lot to choose from.
You let us know and we do a special pricing kind of thing that only, you know, through Debbie, that they're available. Otherwise, galleries get pissed at me for knowing.
No, that's very unusual, because usually galleries don't let the people, the artists, do this.
Well, don't say anything.
Won't say anything. But no, this is very, very special. But
they're not sizes I would have in there, and they don't interfere with it, because the collectors want the large. These are nice size prints, and they're the gallery quality prints, but they're not limited edition. They're dated and initialed on the back or personalized if somebody wants on that.
That's excellent. Okay, so that's the information about that.
It's only available for really limited time. Otherwise, I've got to wipe.
No problem. So just to sum it all up, I just want to promote myself now, just saying these are the things that I'm going to be doing, virtual and in-person programs. And there's a picture of me, I think it was at the Whitney, the Warhol exhibit there. But I have a lot of things that are starting this month. So please look at the website and learn more about all the things that I'm doing. And let's give everybody Richard's contact information and a nice thank you for spending all your time with us.
And by the way, if I could say one other thing about Maika, I'm on Instagram, and because of the nudes and the controversy with the nudes, I lost my Instagram 3 times. I keep starting over. So now it's not just Robert Farber, it's under Robert Farber Photographer. So if you want to follow me on Instagram, you're welcome to do it. But come to Farber.com and Women's Art Field, whatever. Anyway, Debbie, but thank you. It's been a very nice interview, and I want to thank everybody for what an interest in coming. And I'm open to any questions you have, if it's still okay.
Of course. I see Suzanne just wrote that it was a terrific presentation and that you're so articulate, engaging, and fascinating to listen to.
Wow.
And she said, isn't that nice? And she wrote, and Debbie, fantastic job curating and moderating. Thank you so much. Well, thank you. I'll tell you, having this the chat feature so that people can make comments as we're going along, isn't that nice, Robert? That it makes it so
easy. Of course, absolutely. You ran it beautifully. And thank you, and thank everyone for coming.
Thank you, and thank you so much. And we will definitely keep in touch, and more people are writing thank you as we're going, as everybody's inspired. Oh my goodness, the comments are coming in faster than I can read them, Robert.
And like I mentioned, if anyone really wants to know specifically about any images, we could go on a Zoom together with Debbie, and I'll be happy to explain it.
Absolutely. You can see we're both very open to talking about anything you want to ask and very excited. So I'm going to let people write these comments in. Robert, I'm going to say goodbye to you, and then I'm going to show this video. One more video as we're saying goodbye. Everybody can fade out. How does that sound?
It sounds good. Don't talk behind my back.
I won't. Don't you worry. Okay. Well, no, you don't have to leave, but I'm just telling you, I'm going to stop talking.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
On fire, and no one could save me but you. It's strange what desire will make foolish people do. I never dreamed that I'd meet somebody like you, and I never dreamed that I'd lose somebody like you. What a wicked thing to say. I'm not afraid to
Robert. And thank you, everyone. Take care.
Thank you, everyone.